Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Mix Tank Takeover with me. My name is Mark Abrams, and I'm going to be taking over Mix Tank on Puremix. And we're going to be listening to mixes from the pro members, giving some comments. The chat's going to help me out and drop their comments on mixes in there as well. And if you're unfamiliar with Mix Tank, this is what it looks like. There over on the left, we have a bunch of songs normally. I pulled one up already, so we see that one if I remove my search thing. So these are all of our submissions over here on the left. We have a timeline here where we can drop comments and feedback. And over on the right, we've got some information about the song as well as the user there. So we'll be reading that before we go and listening to as many mixes as we can today. So because we're kind of on a bi-weekly thing and we got a whole lot of stuff to do with AES next week, I'm going to jump right in and we're going to start listening to some mixes. So hello, everyone in the chat. Thank you guys for coming in again. I see a lot of familiar names, which is amazing. One thing I do want to talk about before we get going here is we have a Pure Mixers Hangout at AES coming up on October 20th at 7 p.m. at Flux Studios in New York City. So if you've never been to Flux, it's an amazing place. There are multiple rooms. At this point, I've lost track of how many there are. But there's two new ones that you're going to be able to see if you come out. There's the Transporter Room and the Dolby Atmos Room. And Fab's Room has gotten a makeover since the pandemic as well. So if you've ever been there before, it's been flipped around. He's got some different monitors in there. There's a whole new desk, a whole bunch of outboard gear. It's going to be a lot of fun to drool over. And it's going to be a good time. So we're going to have some pizza, hang out, nerd out, drool over gear, and definitely have a roof hang in there somewhere. So I'm going to put a link to the sign-up form inside of the YouTube chat here. And there you go. Hey, Jeff. Cool. Smoking Fudos in the chat. Eon Music, Martin Gavel, Eon Tube. Awesome to see all you guys. This is awesome. Jeff Kleiser joining in from Hollywood. Flandy Bob. Somebody is here from Mars, I saw, so that's pretty cool. I don't know if you went up on the rocket or hitched a ride, but awesome. So yeah, we're going to dig in here. Flandy Bob was the first person to show up today. So we're going to start out with Flandy Bob's mix. And after that, we're going to use this little draw a track button at the top. And as long as it's being random and not showing us stuff that we've already seen, we're going to try and use that. Otherwise, I'm going to flip over and we're going to try to get everybody that's in the YouTube chat. Thank you guys so much for showing up. I always want to try and listen to your mixes since you took the time out of your day to come here and join us live too. So let's see how it goes. Today, we're going to try it out. We're going to start with Flandy Bob. We'll try our draw track button after that. So this song is called Learn. This is mix 1.5. And he says, okay, last try before I soothe up on Black Friday. Nice. So when you get soothed. Okay. Awesome. Yeah, let's check it out and see if you'll need some soothe or not. All right. There's always other options too, though. So, okay, here we go.
Out of time, help me cause the time has come.
Killer job, man. Wow. Awesome. The guitar section is so Floyd. It's amazing. And you've nailed that tone. I love this. Yeah, a couple things. And I think that this is insanely close. So one thing I'm going to point out, just because we're here at the end, there's, as you're kind of coming out of the solo, there's a resonance that pops out of the guitar that I think you could automate a little EQ on to resolve. So let's check that out. Sorry, maybe a little before. Yeah, just this last note. There's a little bit of like a low mid honk that kind of pokes out at me. So it might be worth just automating and not removing all the body from it, because that's part of the coolness, and that, you know, that tone's kind of freaking out inside of all the saturation and, you know, distortion that you have. But maybe just getting it so it doesn't kind of like poke out and mask stuff for that brief second that it's even there. It's not a big deal, even if you don't touch it. But I thought I'd just mention it because I heard it right at the end there. So I had a couple thoughts as the mix was going on playing. So the first one, I was kind of, you know, listening for it because you mentioned that you're talking about Soothe. There was some stuff I think you were working on with resonances and all that. So trying to make things not be harsh, right? So that's what I was listening for, is like, what is it that you're hearing that you think you need to grab Soothe on Black Friday, which is a wonderful time to get it. So I was thinking, okay, like the vocal, the first thing that kind of like poked out to me was there's a little bit of resonance in some of the notes on the vocal. It's got that like 2K, 3K, 4K in that range thing that like pokes out and stabs you a little bit, right? So that's probably what you're thinking about with Black Friday. Or with Soothe. So I've talked before on the stream about this, where when you have a problem, you have to ask yourself, like, I have a little flow chart that like my brain goes through whenever I'm dealing with stuff like this. So it's, is this a temporary problem or is it a permanent problem? Meaning like, is this a problem with the vocal tone all of the time? Or is it only happen in moments? And there's an old saying that you should never fix a temporary problem with the permanent solution, right? So Soothe is great because it's adaptive and all of that. But sometimes you can get around using something like Soothe, which is an awesome tool that I use all the time. I have a little quick key on my Stream Deck to add it to tracks and all of that. But it is always doing something to your sound, even when you kind of don't necessarily need it to be, right? Like it's always adapting and using like multiple EQ bands to pull things out. And I try to avoid using it where I can by, again, like the ending thing, just automating EQ bands. So if it's like a Pro Q3 or whatever it happens to be, I'm in love with the Big Freak lately. But I'll automate a band just for those moments to just smooth that out to taste and then be done with it and not think about it again. So without having to spend any money on Black Friday, you could try doing that first, because I think it's only on certain words that it pokes out. So just do a listen, and in your DAW, I would just drop a marker every time that you hear the thing that bugs you, then go to that spot, try automating EQ and see if you can just smooth it out. And if it doesn't work and you feel like it's a global problem, Soothe is going to, you know, hopefully get you in the right spot for that. So that was the one thing I was listening for on the vocal. And then as I was kind of going on, my next thought was, I wonder if the snare could be brighter. But then I was listening to the other instruments, and everybody's sitting in the same kind of mid-range tone place, which is also style appropriate, like with what you have going on in the guitar solo and everything. This sounds like a record of the time that inspired it, if that makes sense. So it sounds like it's in the right tonal characteristic and all of that, and the mid-range feels good and all that. So then I was, you know, kind of, this is everything that went through my head. I was asking myself, why do I think the snare should be brighter? And the reason for that was the bass finger noise feels very bright to me. So the bass notes were kind of like sticking out. Anytime there was like a slide or any kind of pick or, you know, picking, I'm not sure which one it was on this track. I don't remember now. But it was sticking out of the speakers compared to every other element of the mix to me. And that was telling my ear, here's where the top end of this record is where this bass is bright. But that's not necessarily correct. It's just the brightest thing in the mix at the moment, right? So what my head went to next was, if you dull that out or just balance it more so it's more laid back in the track and feels like more of the same recording, if you will, I think that the snare would feel just fine. And then my next thought was, I think the kick drum's too loud. But what the bass thing might be telling you, like, the bass is this loud because it's this bright and it's this close. That's the other thing, is like with all the high frequency, I felt like the bass was closer than everybody else. So I think if you adjusted the tone of the bass guitar, what's going to happen is you're going to feel like the bass is quieter because it's not as bright. And that's going to possibly tell you that the kick is too loud, and you might have to fix the kick bass relationship based off of the tone that you choose for the bass guitar. Those are things that happen to me all the time, where it's just like one thing will, you know, kind of be poking out, and I'll realize, oh, I was setting the other element of the mix appropriately to that thing, but it was kind of out of balance with itself. So then I have to redo the relationship of that. So kick might be too loud after you adjust the bass thing if you go in that direction with it. But that's all I got, because I think the track's awesome. Yeah, amazing job, Flandy. Thank you so much for showing up in the chat today and being here. It's amazing. All right, I'm going to check in on you guys in the comments. And yeah, lots of good comments for you in there. Everybody digs this. Nice. Martin says, I like the PF-ish vibe. I think you're talking about an aquatic being. Okay, so Mike Ornsby is here. Nice to see you, Mike. You posted an original song, Rough Mix. Let's check it out. Let's go check it out now. And then after this one, I'm going to hit the draw track button. And then we'll see how it's working today. All right, cool. Studio Jamon, here we go. Awesome. And I'll be reading your notes over on the right as we go. You guys probably can't read them because the text gets a little bit jarbled on the screen, but I'll read them, and then we'll go over them at the end. Here we go. I'm going to make a comment just here while I'm hearing it as we're going. Listen to the acoustic guitar. And this is one of those things I was just talking about with Flandy Bob's track, where sometimes you have a resonance poke out, but it's not there in the rest of the, you know, the rest of the performance or whatever. It's just one note gets excited on the instrument or in the chain, whatever happens. So the acoustic guitar is doing that to me here. It's got one note that just kind of pokes out and comes out at you. And it's a little bit... like it's got a little bit of a mask or a resonance to it. So I'm going to play from back here. You'll hear it when it comes, and I'll wave my arms or something. Here we go. So that's one of those things you could just like automate an EQ, just take care of that note, or even automate the volume of that spot too. It doesn't always have to be automating EQ and being complex. You could just turn the note down, or you could cut it up, clip gain it down, whatever method works for you. Here we go. Man, Mike, I love your music, as you know. Thanks again for posting another one. So I just had a thought on that guitar thing, and that's, as we're going into the guitar solo, there's definitely, obviously you're playing with a lot of dynamic and we don't want to kill that. But it does get lost a little bit in the quieter stuff. And I'm wondering if, you know, if you just try a little bit of compression on this guitar, it might solve the other problem that I pointed out earlier too. It could just be that it needs a little bit more compression. So here we go. Let's listen to the solo with that in mind. You know, one thing about, sorry, I'm like talking through this. One thing that's cool about not having the compression that's feeding into that reverb. So let's say that you do compress this guitar more. If you wanted to keep the same splash effect that's happening from the reverb, you could send an uncompressed version or the current version of this guitar into that reverb and then do your other dry one, you know, or your other compressed version in parallel with it. Because I like when you do those big, you know, the big picks on the guitar, those notes go into the reverb and splash out and create a whole ambience around them, which is really, really neat. Michael Brower talked about doing that technique, like sending the pre-compressed version of like a vocal or an instrument into a reverb so that you get that like movement that you don't necessarily hear on the dry compressed track, but the reverb's reacting to those dynamic moments. So just a thought, it could be something fun to kind of play with. Here we go. Awesome. Man, Mike, again, love your music. Thanks again for submitting on here. There was a, as it was going on, I was considering Laban's comment here about more lows in the snare. Seems a little lightweight in my opinion. And I was listening to the top end of the snare and the entire track feels like it has a sort of like an enhancement plugin going on with it, like something's exciting the top end of the entire mix, because the same kind of brightness that I hear on that snare is the same thing that I hear on other elements that were making me feel like the mix was a little bit bright. So I'm wondering if you have like stereo EQ or some kind of exciter, even like Sugar can do this, if you have it set to like excite or you play with like the yin and yang thing on the top band, if you kind of go a little bit too far with it, it feels kind of like this texture or like that Dolby A kind of enhancement or like an oral exciter, those kinds of things. The top feels a little bit like that to me, but not in an extreme way. It's like a couple clicks maybe more than I would go, but it's also, you know, of course, like a completely subjective thing. So yeah, I love your track and always love your music. The it's hard to comment on the brightness of individual instruments because I do hear that kind of mix globally, the top end of that globally. Somebody commented de-esser, and I would start with, if I'm right, that there's something on the mix bus that's doing that whole top end texture thing. Play with that and see if you can get it, you know, somewhere where you like it, where you still feel as much of that effect as you want, but maybe a little less. And you, things you could listen for as you're kind of tweaking it, if you play with doing less of it, listen to the top end of the snare and to the S-ing on the vocal and some of the cymbals and the shiny percussion stuff that you have on the sides and all of that. And see if you bring it down, if it kills those things for you, then obviously you set it where you wanted. But I would listen to those things as I was turning that back. And then I would maybe consider things like, is the snare too bright, or is there too much, you know, too many S's on the vocals, which there very well may be. But yeah, great comments in the chat too. Oh yeah, cool. Yeah, Mike, you said yes on the top end. Cool. Yeah, lots of great comments in there. Everybody likes the song a lot. There was a comment from Jeff, maybe parallel compression on the guitar. Yeah, great song. To point out to everybody, there's a lot of information on this track. If you look it up on Mixtank, you can search Studio Jimon. I'm probably mispronouncing, sorry if I am. But you should read this because it's pretty interesting. He talks about the meaning of the word midi. I'm going to embarrass myself, but I'm okay with it. Meduinen, I think. But the translation is sounding of the heart woman. And he talks at the end about how this is it's a love song for his partner. And it's pretty awesome. You guys should read this. So there you go. He says, I play guitar better than I sing. I think you do well, both just fine. All right. We're going to hit the draw a track button and see what we get. Here we go. Our next track is Close to You from Joe. Here we go. Okay, I have thoughts so far. I'm just going to get them out while we're going here. So the vocal in the beginning feels a little bright to me. And another kind of going back to mix number one here from Flandy Bob. How do we get here, right? And on his, it was, I think that there's, you know, the top end of the bass was telling him that the kick drum was too quiet, so he was turning it up. I could be wrong. But on this one, as soon as we get to this pad here, it's doing a lot of like 300, 200, kind of like, you know, not mud, but like some masking, and there's some body to that tone. And if you were going with the vocal right there, it would cause me to cut that information out of the vocal if I felt like the vocal was getting boxy. So I think an inverse of that, where you cut some of that information out of the pad, would allow the vocal to sit better and you could bring some of the body back up in the vocal. Totally guessing, but here we go.
Thank you.
I just want to talk about the sub information on the kick through here. There's a whole lot of sub information going on, and I don't think that you need all of it to get the same impact that you want. So lots of videos do this on the site where you can use something like any EQ, honestly. If you just do a high pass filter, you can shave off just a little bit of that sub information. You know, you could go as low as 36 and feel this, or like up higher. But basically you could use like a sharp slope on it and just kind of tame some of the very bottom stuff. So if you're cutting off like under 36, it's not brick wall cutting it, it's a taper. But not causing your speakers to have to reproduce all of that information down there is going to allow them to be more punchy in the stuff that you care about, like the fundamental. So I would play with that, and I don't think that you're going to lose the bottom thing that you want from having that much low end. I think it's just going to help make that kick a little bit clearer and a little bit punchier, and I think it'll let you bring it down in volume a little bit because you'll be getting the effect that you want. So just something I wanted to point out there. There's some other things that we're going to talk about in a minute, like the vocal sounds pretty processed. Sonic Science Lab, if you guys can read his comments on here, I think has some good comments for that. So let's keep listening. And I'm going to end up spot checking because this is an 8-minute long song, and I want to be fair. So here we go. When mouse turns to ashes and fame turns to dust, your ways will keep crashing. Hey Karen, welcome. The oceans of your great love, from the depths of my heart, my dear. So things feel a little bit smeared to me here. So like the artificial widening thing, I think is going on a little bit much. The vocal sounds very flat, even though you can tell that he's you know, emoting and being more dynamic than what we're hearing here. Like it's a little overcompressed. And then there's also some other processing going on in the top end of the vocal that feels a little bit overdone. And in general, I'd say it feels a little out of focus through here, but I'm familiar with the genre as well. And I know that that's common, very common, as well as like the reverbs feel sort of, like they're almost, you know, they're pretty loud, I guess I would say. I was going to say like, you know, they're up there with the vocal, but they kind of, the mix feels like it's all kind of one dimensional on a flat plane instead of having a bunch more depth. So I think like less compression on the vocal would allow a little bit of back wall to it. So I've talked about that a lot on here. You know, if we imagine the vocal being here, we want to paint a back wall with some of those reverbs and effects to kind of give the mix depth and like a 3D feel to it, which when you start going for stereo widening tools that kind of do it artificially, they're kind of like pulling the mix, like, you know, almost like dough or whatever, and stretching it that way. But you can get that same effect if you just have some 3D depth, you know, front to back inside of the mix. So That was just a thought. I'm going to skip forward a little bit here, and let's check out what's going on up here. Hey, Christianos, welcome. So just listening through here, the kick and the snare especially feels nice and like there's a lot of texture to it. There's a lot of detail. I like the sound of it. I like how close it is, but it's way less lush than everything else. Good word, Karen. I saw you in the chat there. It's way less lush than everything else that's in the track, and it's more in focus and closer and drier and all of that. And I feel like a couple more elements doing that would help out the mix, particularly the vocal. And then that's going to accentuate the rest of that big open feeling because we're going to have some contrast. We don't know how far away something is if we don't see anything close to us, right? So, yeah, all that cross perspective. Let's go a little bit past this build up here and see what's happening. Here we go. Yeah, so overall compression as well, like we got this, you know, we're going from this build to this big section, and while I can hear that the players are, you know, everybody's more intense and there's, you know, a lot more going on, it's like drums kind of have this halftime thing going on, the energy didn't go up there. So I'd also take a look at the mixed bus compression and see what's going on with the two bus processing, because that could be contributing to that feeling of like everything's on a flat plane instead of having some depth to it too, right? Because if we smash everything together, we're going to have a pancake that's, I think of it in like layers, right? So we would have one flat kind of plane. So maybe take a look at that and let's check out some stuff over here. Also, with the drums playing halftime like that, I kind of want to hear the other subdivision, whatever's keeping time there. So if there is a shaker in here, something like that, but also that cymbal that's playing, I think quarters, is going to help fill in the time there while the kick and the snare are doing the halftime. So always be thinking musical, you know, musicality with balance too, like who's keeping time. That guy needs to be heard in a clear way instead of a wash too. Here we go.
I wanna be close.
Very cool. The combination of the piano and the acoustic guitar here, they're both playing the same fundamental, and it sounds like a there's a virtual instrument from Native Instruments that has very cottony felt on the end of it. Una corda, that's the name of it. It sounds like that instrument, but it's playing the same fundamental as the acoustic, and it sounds like a resonance thing that's doing some masking. So I would potentially play with like panning on those, or just balance a little bit more and let one of those take the range more than the other. So we'll just listen to that couple bars one more time, and then we'll move on. Yeah, very cool track, Joe. I think you've got a lot of great stuff going on here, and I hope that the comments are useful. I'm going to put my little thing on here. Sonic Science Lab had some great comments there, and the chat as well. So definitely check out both of those things. And thank you so much for submitting. All right, let's move on. Chat. I think I know what you guys are going to say, but do you want me to listen to some tracks from people who are here in the live stream, or you want me to keep hitting the draw track button? It's your show too, so we can figure this out. All right, I'm going to hit draw a track while I wait, and then you guys all duke it out in the chat and let me know what you want to do. All right, here we go. Chris Rue, here we go.
Sembró caña, panela y azúcar, dulce esfuerzo de un sudor. Soy el sueño de un pintor, un color de un picaflor. Esta brocha acariciado el canvas, hoy pintando alegría en dolor. Sueño de mil colores, cambian como las estaciones. Estos sueños viven plasmados en todas las constelaciones. Que camino, van pintando mi destino. Al otro lado de esa montaña, tu corazón te esperará. No importa la caída, las heridas te enseñarán. Al otro lado de este camino, tu corazón se llenará de experiencia y sabiduría, y tu meta se cumplirán si solo
sueña en pintar. Y solo
Amazing, Chris. Awesome. Very cool track. This is fun. Everybody was kind of digging it in the YouTube chat too. Okay, so I would mostly echo a lot of what Sonic Science Lab and Tomfoolery are saying on this one. So there's a groove thing that isn't happening for me yet, and it's kind of what they talk about too here in the weight of the track. So it doesn't feel like there's a very firm foundation under there. It feels a little light in the bottom, and yeah, like the bass, the kick, all of that groove is what is pushing us forward and making us want to dance to the song, right? So we need some more of that foundation, a little bit more of the drum that's going to push us and make us want to go out and dance to this. Sonic talked about some boxiness in the vocal making things poke out of the mix. I would say that that's true with any resonance in any instrument, really. But anytime that you have a resonance, it's going to cause the track to pop out of the speakers and be a little too loud, right? So I would potentially look at the tone of the vocal, but also the lead and the backgrounds just feel like they're a bit too loud and popping out of the mix, while the horns feel like they're very recessed and pulled back and down in the mix. And the horns on a track like this, to me, are an essential part of the groove because they're so syncopated and everything, right? So it really has a big part of how the time is felt. So I would, if you can, do a save as, and I would play with your balances and just think about inside of the track. I do like that you have a vocal focus on here and that you're focusing on the song and all of that instead of just trying to make like a huge sounding backing track or whatever. But I would play with balances a little bit more. If you can do a save as, and maybe this is just a practice thing and you don't even make another mix out of it, and you go back and tweak this one, and that's fine. Practicing is important for mixing just as it is important for learning your instrument, right? So, and I feel like we overlook that a lot. Like, it's like anytime we do a mix, it has to be like for a final mix that gets released, and that's not true. Like, I'll sit down and just do something in 20 minutes that I know is never going to see the light of day, but it just helps me learn, right? So practice mixing the same way that you practice an instrument. Off the soapbox. All right. So I would do a save as, play around with some balance stuff on this and see if you can get the track making you want to dance more. See, pay attention to like how your body's moving and all that, and if you're feeling it. And then bring in all of the important, you know, background vocals and everything else around it, your lead vocal, all of that, and just see if things are fitting well. That's not to say like never start with a lead vocal in a mix or anything like that. I just think in this track it'd be benefit from playing around with the balances a little more. But yeah, great track. I think it's going to be awesome. And I hope that that is useful. So let me put my comment on here. And yeah, definitely check out... check out the YouTube comments. Isomatic says, the kit felt a little bit light to me. I didn't say anything because I don't know if that's normal for this type of genre. Mirko says, this could be the next summer hit. There you go. Yeah, crank up those horns. Great job. I think it's going to be awesome. Here we go. Next one. Okay. Next one again, because we already got that one before. That was Flandy Bob. Yes. User 12410807 29. My favorite username. The song's called Hormone. Let's check it out. Here we go. Oh, and then we're going to be choosing songs from the chat. I saw your votes. Here we go. First thing I want to point out is just the S-ing on the vocal, so we'll pay attention to that as we go from here, but the S-ing is pretty harsh. There's some stuff in the guitar before, we'll get to all that in a minute. Here we go. Ooh, I want more of those toms right there. If you're going to put those kinds of toms in, you got to crank them. It's like a natural law of the universe. Here we go.
You're my head.
This feels really cool in here. I like this section a lot. And I just want to point out while we're here, the kind of going back to one of the tracks a minute ago, I was talking about like the elements of the mix that are keeping time in the arrangement, like the pieces of, you know, instrumentation that are keeping time. They're very important to be audible because it keeps momentum going throughout the song, right? So the hat that comes in on this bridge section, that feels like it needs to be a little more present and focus so that I keep momentum going. So I'm just going to back up a couple bars, and as we go into here, just kind of listen for where the level of that hat is at. Here we go. Also, again, make a moment out of these toms. I can't go by it without saying it because they're so cool. I would crank them up because we're going into the last chorus. It needs to be like, ah! It's like when the big drop happens at a rave or whatever. Which, guys, don't let me forget to tell you who I saw live last night. Don't let me forget in the chat. I'm counting on you guys. All right, here we go. Awesome. Very cool. Make sure that cut at the end is intentional. I think I hear a little digital pop there at the very end, so just make sure that you're cool on your fade. Yeah, sounds awesome. The drums, it's nice to hear them by themselves there. That told me a few things, and they're nice and punchy, which is cool. The kick, Tom pointed out, it has a little resonance in the 80 hertz area. That sounds about right. I was going to, like, you know, that 80 to 120-ish area is really guilty of stealing punch away from kick drums everywhere. We need shirts about it and picket signs, and we need to go after it. But just watch out for that because it could be stealing some of the transient energy with just a little too much resonance in there. So maybe a little dip right there might help the kick punch a little bit better. So let's talk about the vocal first. Tom points out you do a great job of keeping it on top of the mix. Totally agree with that. It feels a little overcompressed to me, which is potentially causing some of our over sibilance kind of stuff to happen. I would play around with your approach to the compression on that vocal before going after de-essers and everything with the processing that you already have. And one of the things I wanted to suggest is parallel compression on the vocal. Just something that is a very compressed version of that vocal to tuck up underneath a less compressed or uncompressed version of it will help you keep some of the natural dynamics, but still give you that, like, that thick in your face vocal sound that stays on top of a mix like that without being overcompressed and getting the artifacts like too much S-ing or certain consonants being, you know, choked up and becoming unintelligible and everything. I don't know the language, so I can't tell you that that's happening, but I do hear compression artifacts on some of the consonants, and I don't know if it's making the vocal less intelligible in this language. But that's the kind of stuff that I listen for on vocals, is just, is it, you know, messing up intelligibility, basically. So other than that, I think the vocal, like, you might be able to automate it a little bit more too. If you have a more dynamic vocal, you can ride the fader and bring it up and down and all of that. Definitely ride those toms, as I mentioned. And then other than that, I think it's a great song, and I think you got a lot of really cool stuff going on. So I'd say just check out those issues first, and then see where you're sitting at. Let's see what the chat had to say. Chat, what'd you guys think? Smooth breakdown. They like the breakdown. They like the song. Very cool. All right. Oh, nice. Isomatic says the worst part about mixed reviews is hearing the great songs like this that are unreleased, so you can't go buy or stream them, and you have no clue if or when you can. So, user 124108072 9, put a comment on your track and let people know when this will be available, who the artist is, and where they can go hear it. I know the name of the song is Hormone, but if you just search Hormone on Spotify, you'll have less offensive results than Google, but it's still going to be a little confusing. So yeah, let people know for sure. And if you're in the chat, definitely let everybody know there too. So cool. That's great. People want to go stream your song. That's fantastic. All right, let me check the chat for anybody who's here that submitted a song. All right, so you guys said let's choose songs from the people that have showed up. If you guys can, yell at me in the chat and drop your song titles and usernames, and then we'll check them out. Sweet. Oh, Tomboy Moss. Yes, dude, Primetime. Are you kidding me? This is awesome. All right, so... Tomboy is one of my favorite bands, like actually one of my favorite bands, not just saying that. Yes. All right. Primetime mixed a song called Moss from a band called Tomboy. They are a duo from Brooklyn. And if you look at their Spotify numbers, it's abysmal and it's depressing because they are literally one of my favorite bands. Fab mixed the original record. You guys can watch Andrew Sheps mix it on the site as well, and you can download the stems and mix it just as Primetime has here. I'm so excited to hear this. This song is actually in my reference mixes too. Like, it's on my very short list of reference mixes because I love the bottom end of this. So I know the original mix inside and out. I can't wait to hear your take. Primetime Robots, let's go. That was cool. Something to listen to on this section as we go in here. This synth, the tremolo kind of feeling thing here, right here. There is a lot of sub information on this. So high pass filter is going to help you out, but it's like on my system, I'm hearing like a, you know, kind of thing in the very bottom of the range here. So yeah, high pass. Well, to high pass or not to high pass is the question, because that's cool. And maybe I'm just saying that because I know the original so well. Listening again. Man, cool take. It actually has a pulsating feeling that the original doesn't have because all of that bottom is in there. I still think it's too much, but don't go too crazy because that feels pretty awesome. All right, moving on. There's a high ring in the kick drum that's poking out, just a high resonance, like a very single frequency that's just ringing. I would probably get rid of that because it's making the kick poke out of the mix in an awkward way, like it's too bright. So checking it out. Mm-hmm. I was going to try and whistle it, but I can't whistle that high. So the mallets are very, very quiet through this section. They enter in on this last line of the lyric, and I feel like they're a key part of the arrangement that helps it grow a little bit more before we go into the next section of that boombastic bass thing. So maybe check that out. That would be a decision that, you know, if you were turning this into a producer, I would be respectful of their arrangement there. Like, that part comes in, it's serving a purpose, so just making sure that it's you know, loud enough or whatever. I feel like the clap is pretty important in this section. It comes, depending on how you're counting it, it's coming on four, you know. I think that could be a little bit more present because it kind of accents off of the two like big hits on that tom feeling thing. And then in this section too, with the mallets, they're the new element coming out of this section of the tom thing. The toms, all of that's still there, but now we have those new melodic instruments. I would make those a little bit higher to support and say, hey, new section that's a couple bars long. Here we go. That was cool. Turn it on, the light back on. A skeletal mask must be under. I say it again, how I begin to crawl back out from under. 'Cause it's easy to pretend. Whoa-oh. Bat Blue in the YouTube chat just said, boring. Bat Blue, I will die on this hill. This is one of my favorite bands. Easy. All right, here we go. Awesome, Primetime. Great work. A couple things that I mentioned in there. One big thing for me, a thing that I really like about the original is how dry the lead vocal is, right? It's so in your face and it's so uncomfortably dry and close and intimate. And you wanted to go in a different direction with it, which I think is really cool. You're doing like a short chorusy, it either sounds like a dim D chorus thing to me or like a micro shift or something like that. There's something phasey about it though. Like it's too wide. So I don't know if it's got a widener on it. Watch out for that. I think like the level of it too, you could accomplish the same effect with a little bit less of it and being a little bit more subtle about it being on there. I think if it just comes down in volume, it's going to actually help the vocal pop a little more. And then, yeah, just the other thing is like, I would just pay attention to the instruments in the arrangement and how they appear and making sure that you're serving the arrangement and the producer's intention as the song is progressing. I love that thing that you did in the transition coming out of the bridge section. The second time that we hear that thing that I thought needed more low pass, but it was also kind of cool that you didn't. More high pass, but it was also cool that you didn't. Second time we heard that, I liked what you did on the end of that transition. That was really, really neat. So yeah, awesome. And the tom thing in that section is really, really hard to mix. I don't think you overdid it with the low end on that, which is very easy to do. So kudos on that. That feels pretty cool. Yeah, just play with balances, some automation, check out the vocal effects on the lead and everything. And I think it's feeling really great. So thanks for being here. Thanks for submitting one of my favorite songs to check out too. So that's awesome. And Bad Blue, I'm going to find out where you live. Not that this is being recorded or anything. Okay, let's move on to our next one. Let's see. Did anybody else post one? Hold on. Did anybody else post one? Yeah, here we go. Wild Ones from Daryl Adams. Here we go. Daryl Ray.
Open up your heart, open up your mind, don't let them keep you trapped inside. They'll never understand.
So I'm going to pause for a second. Daryl, can you let us know where this multi-track is from? Because I think I heard this song on one of the previous ones, unless it was your mix. But I love this song, and if I remember right, it was a multi-track that's available somewhere publicly, which is a great one for practicing. So if you could, drop it in the chat, let us know. Here we go.
The way that you raise your hand, they'll never know just who you are. So keep your head up, keep your kiss the ones you love and dance like you're really having fun. And don't be afraid to fall and go out and risk it all. And don't be afraid of who you are. Just finding out this life is full of fear.
Sorry, I want to talk about something in the bridge here. And we're going to listen just from here. And while we're listening, I want you to think about who's the most important in these moments, or in this moment as it's building up. So we're going to listen up to where the lead vocal comes back in. But who's carrying the song? Who's standing in the front of the stage with the spotlight on them?
Just finding out this life is full of fear and doubt.
So for me, it's the electric guitar there, but the acoustic guy is doing, sometimes they're called diamonds or they're called footballs. It's just, you know, hitting the chord and letting it ring. Those guys are a little bit louder, which I love. They paint the sides in the mix for me. They tell me where the walls are on the sides, and I love that. I love having the reference of that. But the arpeggiated electric guitar that's happening there, I feel like it needs to be a little bit more pronounced, a little bit fuller, and more of a star, if that makes sense. Moving on. Here we go.
It won't stop her now. Life is full of fear and doubt. But it won't stop her now.
There's a high resonance on "it won't stop her now." So on "stop her now," there's a high resonance that's ringing out. See if you can pick it out here.
But it won't stop her now.
Mostly on "stop her," but that's one of those things where I'd either automate an EQ or be looking at Soothe to kind of smooth the vocal out. The vocal also feels louder than is necessary throughout the track to me, and we'll come back to that in a moment.
Don't stop, we're not giving up. Hold on, we got them on the run. It's only them or us. He said he's just finding out this life is full of fear and doubt. But he won't.
So this section, I just want to talk about it really quick. The snare and the cymbal being so loud brings an energy to it for sure. It's a little in front of the vocal, which feels somewhat unnatural to me. And then I've lost the bass guitar in here. The low energy that I was hearing is coming from the acoustic guitars, and I want more of a driving bass. Just as a note, that was a thought I had. Here we go. Man, on that snare cymbal thing being louder than the vocal there, that generates excitement that I've talked about on some of the other streams too, where the Foo Fighters are a great example of this, where on the loudest sections when Dave Grohl is screaming his face off, he's a little behind the snare. It's like he can't get in front of the snare, and that's, you know, adding to the frustration and all that. So there's something cool about that technique, and I like where you've placed it here. It could just be that the snare and the cymbal are a little bit harsh and bright, and it's not a volume issue, but I would just play with that relationship, both in a tonal characteristic and a balance, you know, volume relative, you know, relative level thing. Here we go. One thing about the cymbal snare thing is it is masking, it has to be a little bit loud, but the vocal's also a little loud, so they probably collectively come down, but I can't hear really what's going on with the electric guitar either at this point. So I'm not hearing the whole band. I'm hearing the drummer and I'm hearing the singer in this moment, because that's what I'm being told is the most important thing. So the drummer was probably on like a pneumatic riser that brought him to the front of the stage with the singer on the same riser with him or something. Here we go.
So keep your head up and keep your eyes open. I know where you're coming from. Don't be afraid. Go ahead and fall in love. Run with the wild ones. It's so much you haven't done. It's not too late.
Awesome job. I would check out your editing on the end there too, because the while that guitar is ringing out, I heard some other noise, some things turning off and all that. So check your ending. Make sure that that's smooth. Never neglect the head and the tail. Behave. All right. Overall, the biggest thing for me was I was feeling like the kick and the bass are a little light and nobody's really occupying the range kind of under 80 in a bold way. Not that it needs to be big and subby. This, you know, like some of the Chris Lord Alge, this is totally my interpretation, but some of the Chris Lord Alge mixes also feel that way. And I get going for that style and it has like a mid-range prominence to it that's awesome, and it's in this style too, but I do think that like just a little bit more thunder under, you know, could help. I'm gonna coin that phrase. That'll be like my Browerized term, the thunder under or something. Actually, let's skip that. I don't like that. So anyway, we need a little bit more foundation, I feel. And then yeah, that lead vocal is a little bit too on top. The lead guitar feels a little bit thin to me, like it needs some more body and some more tone to it. Just make sure you're not high passing stuff too much and taking away some of the fundamentals there. But yeah, I love the song, and thank you for posting, Daryl. You said so he got this multi track from Produce Like a Pro, Warren and our friends over there. They had this one available. It's popped up a couple times on Mixtank now, and every time I comment on like loving the song. So you guys should definitely go check that out and download it and give it a shot too. All right, let's check out the chat for people that are here who have submitted the song. Smoking Fudo, dry clean only, ugly. You got it. He says compressed and harsh. All right, we'll see about that. Smoking Fudo also said, I wonder if we send the multi-tracks to Mark Needham. Reminds me a bit of his style of production, like it's my or like it's Time by Imagine Dragons. Totally agree. Yeah, awesome. Cool. All right. Cool, Daryl. Yeah, let me know if I can expand anymore. If you tell me in the chat, I'll try to before we get out of here. Thanks again for submitting it too. Guys, in the chat, let me know who's coming to the Pure Mixers Flux Party, December 20th, 7 p.m., Flux Studios. If you're coming, let me know in the chat. I want to know, like, if I said something wrong on one of these and you're going to come up and slug me in the stomach, I want a little bit of a heads up. Just kidding. But yeah, I'd love to know if you're coming to the Flux Party. So if you're already registered, let me know. If not, I put the link to the sign up form in there earlier. But yeah, we're super excited to hang out. So, okay. Dry Clean Only. You may meet, the singer from Dry Clean Only, Joey, who is an engineer at Flux, as well. And he was in those Dry Clean Only videos. So he should be around at that party. Okay, here we go. There's some kind of pop in there. Yeah, just watch out for edits.
Fire!
Cool. I'm just going to listen to something and then the guitars right here. This is something, I'm pointing it out because I just went through this on a record. Check it out again. Listen to the guitar and the pitch. So intonation on the guitar, not a lot you can do with that, or is there? Because we have Melodyne inside of Pro Tools now. So you might be able to cut that chunk, and you could do it with regular Melodyne outside of Pro Tools. I'm just excited that we have Melodyne and Pro Tools and ARA support and all that. You could always use Melodyne, but I digress. You might want to tweak that a little bit just because it's one of the like things that can pull your ear. It pulled mine. Let's listen to the end. Awesome. This was actually one of my first Puremix shoots, was the dry clean only shoot. So that was back in the day. But awesome, man. The first thing that stuck out to me is the kick drum. So playing that one more time. So a whole lot of sub information on this guy. And what I would try first is just bringing the level down because it's very loud. And this could be a monitoring environment kind of thing. If you don't trust the low end of your room or if you can't hear the bottom of it, this would cause you to push it up too high. There's a room in town here that I work in every once in a while where I don't hear the bottom the same way that I hear it in this room, which is where I work all the time. And every time I go there, I kind of end up overdoing it on the low end. So now I carry headphones with me that I trust for some of that stuff. But I usually just track over there, which is nice. So I can just come back here and work on it. I just know when I go there not to blow the low end up because I'm going to regret it when I get back here. So anyway, might be worth checking out some different sets of monitors, headphones, just different, you know, different, listen to it in different spots and places that you feel you know the low end really well. So I would bring the volume down before doing any like EQ change on it. But once you get it down there, I have a feeling it's going to feel fluffy and not very punchy, which is why you're doing the volume, I think. So high pass filter will help tighten up the bottom of it. Choose like whatever corner, you know, makes it feel good and punchy. I love the back EQ for this. That can't be said enough. Ever since Fab showed me that thing, especially in this context, I've been completely hooked, and that's how I usually fix these issues. So check out the back EQ, but you can do it with any EQ, and play with the slope on the high pass filter. That'll help you figure that out. I think that would clear up a lot of things. And the next one is if you listen to the guitars, they feel like they have a lot of kind of low mid masking going on. And when I say masking, I kind of mean resonance. And it's usually a resonance that comes out so loud that it ends up just being so loud that you don't hear the stuff around it. So think of like the loud guy at a party who's like just talking over everybody and you can't hear anything else that's happening and nobody else is talking because this one guy's being boisterous. That's what I hear in the guitars there. So take a listen. Now, before cutting that stuff too, I think you could. There's not like a specific resonant frequency that's poking out to me. It's just kind of like the low mids are just a little bit too prominent. But you could try boosting up the, you know, like the 2K to 4K region too to bring a little more presence to those guitars. And let me listen to the vocal because it kind of depends on the shape of the record that you want. Let's check it out. 1 second. So reason I wanted to listen to the vocals feel like they have too much like top mid range. The stuff I'm missing from the guitar, the vocals have a lot of. So the thought there is, what is the shape of the record that you want to have? Like if you listen to, I think somebody pointed this out to me with like Paramore records at one point. They were like, oh, this one sounds really mid forward and this one, you know, not so much as more smiley face or whatever. But records have a shape to them. Like there's a tonal shape that you're kind of aiming for, and that's sort of more in the mastering engineer's world, but you want to kind of like figure out the general tone of the record. And then at some point, something becomes too bright and it escapes that overall shape that you had intended for the song or for the mix. And I think that the vocals have exceeded that general, like, you know, average shape that's going on with this mix. I think the vocals have overshot it, and I think the guitars aren't quite there yet. So a little more mid in the guitars, a little less mid in the vocal, and finding like a happy medium between them would probably feel a little more tonally balanced. But I like the overall vibe of this. Let's listen just a little bit more. Yeah, once so the vocals being so like kind of pokey in the upper mids makes me feel like everything else is dark. I wonder how, and the kick drum being too loud also makes everything feel a little bit too dark because it's too big. I wonder if you kind of evened out the playing field a little bit, how other things feel. But I think in general it would be a more balanced track and it would feel really good. So I would just play with that a little bit. The vocal high mid-range thing is kind of throwing my ear off a little bit on it. So I hope that that's useful overall. I think if you address the high mid thing in the vocal, that's going to answer some of the other stuff. That's the general thing. And the kick drum. And then you can decide, like, how are the guitars feeling? I tried to replace also the kick and snare using samples. Actually, drums feel to me a little dense. Is the kick and snare relationship acceptable? So yeah, I just think the kick's a little too loud. Also, cymbals and hi-hat seem washed out. I tried to give it a bit more body, but I didn't get a solid hi-hat and crashes as I wanted to. I also reamped the guitar tracks, and I probably ended up to be harsh too. I don't think they're too harsh. Yeah, I hope that that's useful, Smokin. Thank you, as always, for being here and submitting a track on it. Sweet. Nice. Primetime says, hey, Mark, if I succeed, I'll come, but it's a 12-hour flight to New York. Okay, I'm hoping for your success. Let's see if you can make it there. Cool. So let me drop my comment here, even though you're here. Awesome. And then Marco, I think it was. Yeah, so Marco, Change Your Mind track. This is my fourth mix takeover without having any luck. So, Marco, I hope you're here because we're going to listen to your song. I'm sorry it's been four times until we got to it. Cool. I'm going to put my comment here just in case you left. Let me know if you're still in the chat. And this way you'll see it anyway if you're not here anymore. Okay, so this is from Marco Tolentino, and the name of the song is Change Your Mind. I'm doing the mix and master for the song. Already did the mixing and some process on the master channel. The vocals on the first verses are not yet recorded, but the production is almost finished, I think. Help me to take it to the next level. Thank you so much for your advice. Sincerely, Marco. Okay, so I'm not going to comment yet. Let's check it out, and then we'll see if I still want to comment what I was going to comment. But we'll wait. Here we go.
Eso es lo que dicen. Y tengo a mi manada pa' que a todos pisen. So I don't care.
Optimus Prime just came into your song.
Don't you get it? Change your mind.
I love that. I love that effect. That's awesome. It drops down in the center and then it kind of goes out. That's amazing. I want to listen one more time.
Change your mind.
Super cool. That is awesome.
So I don't you get it. Don't you get it. Change your life. So I don't you get it. Don't you get it. Change your life. So I don't you get it. Don't you get it. Change your
que tú puedas comprar, todas las mujeres dense mucho a respetar, tú si grande eres y tienes humildad, así tú no dejas que a ti te gane la maldad, la dama no es un tema que tú puedas comprar, todas las mujeres dense mucho a respetar, tú si grande eres y tienes humildad, así tú no dejas que a ti te gane la maldad.
There is a pulsating rhythmic noise on top of one of the instruments, and I can't figure out which one it is, right through
here.
It almost sounds like noise that's being ducked by the vocal throughout here. See if you hear it. So it's like the very high hiss noise. It sounds like it's coming from a plug-in, but it sounds like it's being ducked when the vocal's rapping. It's distracting and pulling me out of the song, so that's why I thought I'd point that out. I don't know if that's intentional or what's causing that, but yeah. Okay, I'm going to pause and just talk about this section. Let me go back to the first Optimus Prime.
Change your mind.
So this one sounds duller, and I'm pretty sure that it was affected differently, but the lead vocal that's happening here, the telephone effect, it's very loud and not the attacks aren't very compressed on it, so it's pretty transient. And that's stealing away some emotion from me, especially as we go into the next section. Instead of feeling like we're going up in energy, I feel like we're kind of static moving into that. So let's take a listen one more time from the Optimus Prime. So this synth pad has a resonance. Obviously, the filters are moving and all that, and it's part of the sound. But it gets a little bit bunched up in the low mids to me. But it's part of the sound too. So I don't necessarily want to tell you to go tweak it, but you could look at the resonance in like the somewhere between 140 and 240-ish, guessing. But I would guess somewhere in there. And I just want to listen to the chorus one more time for a comment.
Change your life. So I don't care.
Cool. I think you have some really cool stuff happening in this mix. So I'm just pointing out things that are, kind of jumping out. But the piano vocal relationship here, you have a thin sounding vocal happening, I assume because of processing, or it could have been the mic. But there's not a lot of body to the sound. It's very mid-rangey. And then the piano that's happening in the chorus is louder than the vocals are, and it's in that same range from a arrangement standpoint there. The chord voicings are right on top of the vocal and also mid-rangey. So it's because it's louder and in that same range, it's masking the vocal a little bit to me. And it's one of the things that I've talked about in the other mix tanks, and you said that you've been to four, so I'm sure that I'm going to be a broken record here. But if you are listening to the song, always be asking yourself, who should I be listening to? Who's the feature right now? If you get into a situation like this or you hit a wall, you can kind of just ask some questions and go through a list of those, and it'll kind of point you in the direction. So if I were mixing this right here, I would, you know, just ask myself the question, who needs to be up front? And the answer is not always the vocal. And sometimes the vocal needs to be a little recessed to get a certain emotion across. My screen is refreshing. I hope I'm still live. It says I'm still live. Okay. So I don't know what happened to Mixtank just now. There we go. There we go. So I would just, ask the question, who's the most important there? And just see if some kind of EQ, like letting one of those lead that frequency range a little more than the other one, might help you find a, I forget the word for this in woodworking, but that's what I'm thinking of. It might help them fit together a little bit more. The pieces might come together a little more if you just make some space in one for the other one to exist. Let me listen to one other section here. The kick drum is also louder than the vocal throughout here. The vocal doesn't always need to be on top. I love the emotion that the singer is singing with. If that's you, you have an amazing voice, and I love what's going on here. I like the song a lot too. I'm hearing a Radiohead thing. I'm hearing a Tom York thing, and I love it. And his vocals are definitely not always on top either. So it could be cool. Just if it's not going to be on top, think about who is on top. Should it be the kick drum? Or should it be the piano? Or is there something else that should be living up there? Again, I love your sound design on what I'm calling the Optimus Prime job. That's super cool. And if you have any other questions, let me know in the chat. Dovetail, Jimmy, thank you. Awesome, Dovetail. You could dovetail it. All right, sweet. Really great job, Marco. Sweet, glad to see that you're in the chat too. Woodworking phrase, awesome. Oh, that's your voice. Amazing. Marco, you have a great voice. Thank you for submitting your song. It's not easy to do that and then like hear feedback on a live stream and all that. So really, really great job. His email is on my screen. I'm sorry about that. Everybody should email him and tell him what a great voice he has, because it's pretty awesome. I would love to hear another version of this too. So if you keep working on it, please submit another one. And if you do, I'm Mark at puremix.net. You share your email, I'll share mine. So let me know if you put another version up. I'd love to hear it again, because really, really cool song. And all right, let's see. Dance Kit is asking if we'll do feedback on Balloon Ride. So yes, absolutely. Let me just make sure that there's no one else I'm missing. Cool, I think that's it. So I think this might wrap us up. If there's anybody I missed and it's not a ton of them, drop them in the chat now and we'll try to get it before we get out of here. Thank you again to everybody that shows up. I love seeing you guys here every week, and I hope that you guys can come to Flux, because it'd be cool to meet in person. All right, here we go. Thank you. I'm backing up a little bit. Okay, I want to talk about the mix up to this point because I feel like it just changed. Everything just changed to me at this moment when the drum kit enters. So up to this point, I love the mix. And Laban here says in the comments, he'd like the kick to be a little louder. And I was thinking that that's true. But then on the flip side, it's always interesting. It's like trying to ask the question of... like, why does the kick need to be louder? Is that the kick needs to be louder? Or is it that the top end is too bright or too harsh or somebody else is too loud or whatever it is? You're always like thinking in this opposite day. At least this is how my brain works when I'm mixing, is if I'm like, oh, the kick needs to come up, then I'm like, you know, my brain will go to question two, or does the bass need to come down? Or do those need to dovetail better? Thank you for the word. So yeah, that's kind of the question that I had up to here. And I think that the mix is a little too bright overall. Like, there's a top end EQ on it that's enhancing things. So like 10K-ish and above feels a little bit loud to me. And the whole thing would feel a little balanced if it didn't have quite as much top on it. And it would, you know, basically like in the Pro Q3, let me see if I'm doing this right. So if this would be the top for you guys. I don't know. Let's just say that this is the top and this is the bottom. So if the whole thing went like it, right now, the slope would feel like this. If you just kind of did a tilt EQ, the Pro Q3 has a band that'll do that. And you just kind of like tilted it down, not so that the low end is like over dominating or anything, but just a little bit more even, if you will. I think like it would be in really, really great shape. And then it came to this spot and the drum kit came in and I heard the snare and a different kick thing. So I'm going to back up a little bit. We're going to go through this transition, and then I'm either going to keep listening or I'll stop and talk. Okay, so we haven't heard this kick at all up until this point. We got new players in the game. There's a bass guitar. So here we go. So one thing that's jumping out to me is that the acoustic guitar feels like it's being spread across the stereo image a little bit, and then everybody else feels like they're kind of up the center except for the snare verb. So I think you could play with panning positions a little bit more. I've talked about this a little bit in the past too, but the thing that I got from Dave Pensado's book, he thinks of panning the same way that he thinks of the rule of thirds in photography, which is you have like the center of your image and you have the left and the right, and composing your shots in thirds, right? I'm not a photographer. That's probably the worst explanation of it ever, but it makes sense to me in a mixing platform, and I actually split it up a little further. So I usually start my panning positions from like 0, 12, left to right, 25, then I'll go to 50, then 75, then 100. And the stuff that's out in the hundreds has to be very, very important. So like usually if I'm doing an LCR thing, I actually leave some room out past 75 for things like verbs and all that. That's not a hard and fast rule, and I break it all the time, but those are like starting positions that I think about. So if I got two guitars, for example, I'll put them in one of those positions and be balancing as I go, you know, sort of keep the composition of the shot, if you will. So my point being, you could play around with kind of panning things out across the panning field or across the stereo field throughout that section, because it does feel like everything's kind of up the center right now. So moving on. So I rolled back here a little bit. One, I want to say, Dance Kit, this does feel like a balloon ride to me, which is really cool. It's a well-named song and really cool composition. You had a comment about the guitars being less harsh, and you were working on that. I think you could actually do a low-pass filter on some of these guitars if you're still struggling with it. If you can't accomplish it with a shelf kind of EQ, you know, just doing like a tilt or a shelf on the specific tracks, you could try doing a low-pass filter and taking off some very top stuff. There's a lot of very sparkly stuff on the acoustic right here. And it's the one that's panned in the center. It has a ton of top end on it. I think that you could, if you're boosting up there, bring it back a hair and go for a more balanced sound. Or if it's, you know, just baked in that way, try doing a low pass filter or a shelf and go down with the shelf. But you could also do a low pass filter and take off some of the very top information that you don't need. I think it would make your ears feel a little bit of relief if they didn't hear, you know, if you started rolling off, even if it's at like 17K or something, sometimes that can be what you need. So hopefully that helps. Let's keep going. Yeah, really cool track. Things feel more... For some reason, the kick drum feels better to me at the end of the song. The snare still feels a little bit dark, however. So, yeah, I hope all that helps, and I would just look for the balance between things across it. But I think it's sounding really good, and if you've been on this journey of going this direction, I think you're in the right direction, and I hope it helps. Yeah, so if you have any further questions, let me know. Thanks for being here, too. That's awesome. And let me just drop my... note here in case you want to come back to this. It's around 2 hours in. Cool. All right. And let's see what else we got. We had a couple more requests. So, Isomatic asked what concert I went to last night. So, I wanted to talk about this on the stream today because it was, I had a whole lot of thoughts going through my head at this concert. So I went to see Mark Ribier and Rebier. Mark Rebier. So I'll like show you guys here. Mark Rebier. Yeah, this guy. So Mark Rebier, and he is a live loop artist who got popular by doing like just insane improv live streaming looping. And he has a song about a flamingo that I recommend everybody go listen to, but it's not work safe or family safe or you safe. But you should check it out anyway. But he's since collaborated with a bunch of, you know, massive artists. I think Erykah Badu was one. But people definitely respect him, and he's an amazing musician. But I had all these thoughts. I'm a Flamingo is the one you want to check out off of Loop Daddy 3. So you guys can't read anything on that screen probably, but I can't play it, but that's basically it. That gives you the vibe. But there were 5,000 people at the show. It was completely sold out, and the tickets were $50. And one of my friends wanted to go, so we went. And I was just kind of looking around, and it's like his records are recorded off of the loop station. And of course, that got me thinking, like, you know, these don't necessarily sound very good, but that's not the goal of the music, really. Like, he's making beats, and a lot of the beats are really freaking awesome. But you know, like going through, it's not a thing that we're like, the mixes sound amazing, yet here is this guy that just sold out this 5,000 person venue for $50 a head, and he's on tour, you know, doing it, and he's killing it, and he's hilarious and funny, and I had an amazing time at the concert. Yeah, it was a super good time, but like, it just had me thinking about like, what is it that we're focusing on, and is it always the right things? Because this guy does an amazing job of connecting with the listener. It's hilarious, it's funny, like as he's going through, and he's a very, very good musician, but it's all recorded into like an RC-505 loop station. There's no real mix happening or whatever. His sounds are good, but it's not like a, you know, ever going to be like a, oh my gosh, that's an amazing mix thing. Even though he does do a good job, it sounds good, but it just had me thinking about all that stuff, about what's important and everything. So yeah. Also, that guy's hilarious. So just go look him up, and don't listen in front of your kids. If you have kids, if you don't have kids, don't listen in front of your mom. And if you don't have your mom around, don't listen in front of your boss. And if you don't have a boss, I don't know. If you're going to be offended, don't listen to it. I'm going to move on. Next song. All right. The book, the name of the Pensado book is The Pensado Papers. It's really freaking awesome. Martin says the guitar work in that last one's amazing. I totally agree. You're welcome for the feedback. Yes, I just told you who I saw last night. Okay, so let's check out a couple more songs here. So let's say... three more. So I'm going to do Adam Hope, Come Back Home first. Let's check that one. Okay. Sweet. Yeah, guys, you should definitely go check out that Mark Ribollet. And it's pretty fun. Okay. Come Back Home, Adam Hope. Here we go.
Sitting cross-legged to play guitar on my bed in South America. You're a sea of love, now I'm swimming in oceans of worries. It's been a year and I don't know what to do. Oh.
This note on the guitar, the... That guy's poking out a little bit. That's one of the ones that I would probably bring down with an EQ. And if it just does it throughout the track, that might be a good candidate for Soothe or a dynamic EQ band to kind of deal with that. Here we go. Wow.
Hoping that you come back home to me. I don't need you, but we felt so good. I let go, hoping that you come back.
First of all, this is beautiful right here. This is amazing. And I'm listening for mouth noise in between these two phrases here as I go through. But man, kudos. This sounds great. So over on the right, I hear something. I don't know if it's guitar or mouth.
Felt so good.
That kind of stuff. I've talked about this before too, but that stuff pulls me out of the song and it suspends disbelief, or it interrupts the suspension of disbelief. So if you can, go ahead and clean that up. It should be an easy edit. Isotope D-click, mouth D-click is great for this stuff.
Felt so good. Get to you, and I can't stop but travel back in time for just a look, just to... I need to get to you, and I can't stop but travel back in time for just a look, just to touch. Say goodbye was already love. It's been a year and I don't know what to do. Oh.
Adam, sorry, I'm going to bounce around a little here. Okay, let me tell you why I was doing that. So, the one stray kick hit that happens, I felt like it was incredibly loud, although I like the idea of doing things like that to, you know, regain the listener's interest and just so they're like, whoa, what just hit me? I think that that's super cool. That one feels a little loud to me, like it's not necessarily accomplishing that. If you were going for that, if I were trying that, I would do a trick... possibly just making it take up more space. So like maybe that feeds a reverb and it spreads out, you know, and makes a moment of it that way. But the sharp, dry, transient thing feels, or it's not a sharp transient, it's kind of a dull transient, but the dryness of it makes it feel like it's kind of poking out a little bit. And then I went back to the first chorus when I got up here because I thought that things got a little too loud. And I was completely blown away by this first chorus, so I wanted to hear that in retrospect. I know new players have entered the party here at this chorus, but I wanted to see what was kind of going on different. So let's listen to a little bit of this one. And the first thought I have there is the same thing with the kick drum. I think it's too loud. So if it's just sitting at a static level, and that's why we have the loud stray hit in verse 2, that could be what's going on there. But I think it's too loud in this chorus, but let's take a listen. And then one other comment, I think the instrumentation is beautiful. I think like the vocals are gorgeous on this. In this chorus, the vocals are the star. Come back home to me. I don't need you, boy. Felt so good. But in chorus 2, they sit behind all the new players that have entered into the song here. So listening to a little bit of this one, listen to the vocal, listen to the other elements of the mix. So a lot of the low mid stuff, there's some resonance, like I would start looking around 300-ish for one of the resonances that are happening in there. But the low mids of that bring it up closer to me and more present. And one thing to think about, this is something I like try to remember to do, like if I'm just, you know, out in the world or whatever, you're out at the supermarket or whatever it is, or you're having conversations with people in a room. I like listen to the effect of like their voice. If I get closer to them or further away, what happens to their voice? And those are the things, like those observations are what you take to going in to mix a song, right? So if I'm having a conversation with a friend and, you know, we're close to each other, but then we're walking away from each other or something, I try to make a mental note of like what's happening to the sound of their voice. Is it getting thinner and all of that stuff? So low mids being close has a proximity feel to it. And they feel closer to me than the vocalist, if that makes sense. So I would try to make some more space for the vocal and get some more intimacy from the vocal right through that section. Here we go. This is almost amazing. I'm holding on too tight. Maybe that's a sign. You gotta leave my mind. Okay, this first part of it's completely taste. So you do that like reverse swell up and then the cut, and then there's a reverb tail that keeps going underneath. I say like make it feel like you just drove off of a cliff and the bottom's gone and it's just her voice out there by itself about to fall from gravity, but it's going to get caught by the next chorus, right? So she goes out over the cliff, the foundation's gone. I would be drastic and get rid of that reverb tail and just make her be there by herself and live in that moment. And then there's a click that happens or a pop on the right side. That pulled me out of the moment of like, I was drawn into her vocal and I was like ready for this big chorus to happen. I felt like I was like floating out there with her. And then the pop happened and I was like, hey, who hit me in the head? I'm trying to listen to this. So let's check that out one more time here. Yeah, that'll just be so much more emotional if she's there by herself and the pop doesn't happen and maybe the reverb's gone. But that part's, that's taste. That's up to you. One more time. Pretending that those things happen.
You gotta leave my mind. I'll let go. Hoping that you come back home to me. I'll let go. Hoping that you come back.
Adam, I love this track. You're doing a great job. This is awesome. Can you let us know who the artist is? And as was requested earlier, when's it going to be out? Because this is great. Everybody should go listen to this on Mixtank before you can get it somewhere else. Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah, Smoking Fudo says put plus 6 dB on that part. Wow. Like, yeah, I would agree. Bring the vocal up a little bit on that section. Just that section out in the middle. That's beautiful. Martin was asking, are there bass chords? Maybe there's too much low end, close with the low voiced harmonies. Yeah. Just stuff to play with. What a great freaking song, Adam. That's absolutely beautiful. Thanks for being here and thanks for submitting that. Let us know who that is. And yeah, when we'll be able to hear it. You're doing a great job. Great production if you're producing it. It's very, very cool. This time, Jim Ibbett. There we go. Let's go over to that. Yeah. Adam, thanks for being here. That was cool. All right. There it is. All right, here we go.
It's no win situation, the hotting in your heart. At what point did the thread break loose, pull the tapestry apart? It opened up so easily and you showed yourself so clear. Hard to look into your eyes, realize that you're not here. Not trying to make you feel bad, not trying to make you hurt. Thinking about my future, baby, trying to make it work. And I won't call any name, for I have not been saved. Trying to make myself happy, obviously you wait. It's okay, it's alright. Change.
Jim or Jimmy, I don't know which one. Amazing track. I love this. That was fun. So I don't have a whole lot on this. I think it actually sounds really good. The balance is the only thing that I would comment on. Yeah, everybody totally digs this. Over, we got a cowboy emoticon there from Martin. Nice. Yeah, the balance-wise, I think that the everything that's not a main instrument, so you've got like the instruments that are happening out on the sides, those guys are all the star of the show to me in this one. So again, like thinking about like who am I supposed to be listening to? They're wide, which separates them from the center of the band. But with how loud they are, I feel like I have this kind of an image, if that makes sense. You know, my, like, if I'm the singer, like, everybody feels like they're here, and I'm the singer, and I'm back here. So that would be my only comment, is, like, they should feel more like they're back here, and the singer is more in focus, if that makes sense. Yeah, or the other thing... The vocal and the drums feel very well balanced together. The other guys just feel a little bit loud. On the solo sections, I think that they're a great level. So they could come back up there on the solos and you could just do some automation. For the rest of it, I would just pull them back a little bit so I can get a little bit more connected to the lyric and to the singer's performance, just so I can like fall into the song a little bit more. But great job. I really don't even have much to say about this. Nothing was painful or anything like that. The shaker was particularly loud. But it was the kind of thing where, like, if the singer's not singing, like, on the solo section or whatever, you could bring it up, you know, to that level to kind of add time and all that. But, yeah, in general, I would just, I basically just want to hear the everything that's in the center come forward a little bit and the band instruments come back a little bit. I think it's awesome. It's just balanced stuff. So you could automate all that. And very close. Very cool. Thank you for submitting that. All right, I got time for one more here. Let's see. Let me see who we got in here and we didn't get to. Who have I missed? Oh, nice. Jimmy. Great. Okay. So Jimmy says the artist is Corey Quinn. And admittedly, he likes to throw everything, including the kitchen sink and lots of other instruments. I think I heard a kitchen sink in there, like someone was banging on it. That's awesome. Okay, so Carl Gibson submitted, and then Jeff has one too. So OWO Time has come. Secondary remastered track. We're going to check this one out. And Carl, I'll try to go quick and get both of these in here. Carl, I'd like to hear the new version of your mix too. So yeah, let's see. Okay, here we go from OWO. Say, 'cause time has come today. Okay, Jeff, I don't know when this was recorded, but those vocal effects, I'm guessing, were not easy to do at the time that this was recorded. And kudos. That was cool. This guitar on the left here got a little piercing to me and made me want to turn the speakers down. And I was comfortable with where I had them I was turning my monitor controller. I don't even think I touched it on the song, but I was happy with where it was, and I was able to like listen to the vocal and it felt good. And then the guitar solo came in, I wanted to turn it down because there's a screeching resonance in it. So that I would clean up. That'll be easy. You can automate an EQ or use Soothe or something like that. But yeah, you could be specific with an EQ there, just bringing it in at that moment on the left side. Oh man, I remember the Roland 1680. Nice. Okay, in case I didn't say at the top, he says in the comments, I tried to take this old CD master and thicken it up and make it more 3D-ish. So we're working from an old master here. You don't have control over the individual tracks, so this is going to be like a mastering job, right? So I think that the snare has a very sharp transient on it. It is 3D in the sense that like it's coming out of the speakers. I think it's a little much. So if you were doing a process that was making that happen, maybe dial it back a touch. That's just to me on my speakers, what I hear. It feels a little too transient. And if you're not doing it and bringing out those transients, then you might consider compressing it a little bit just to soak some of that stuff up. And sometimes going into things like True Iron from Kazrog, I think is the name of it. That one's really good at just kind of like soaking up really fast transients. The Fairchild 660 from UA, that thing has a transformer emulation that even if you're not using compression, it compresses transients. That feels really cool. I would maybe play with that just to bring those down. And then I would just automate an EQ on that solo there and just make it a little smoother and easier to listen to. After you've been like focused on the vocal, when that comes in, if it's too screeching loud, instead of being like a cool in a punk way, it's a little bit in a painful way that's going to make me go for the volume instead of like, yeah, that's awesome. That guitar is like too loud, you know? So, but this is super awesome. And that, yeah, the vocal effect, it's funny. I mean, it's like, you know, sending to a couple different delays or whatever, but I imagine that wasn't super easy. Whereas like now we'd have that done in 30 seconds, right? So, kudos to you for making this on a Roland 1680. I totally remember that thing. The bass player in my band had one. It was pretty insane. We were excited when he brought it home. All right. Cool. And thanks, Jeff. Awesome. Let's see what else we got here. There was one other tune I wanted to get. Okay, The Symmetry of Chaos. And I was going to get to Carl Gibson. Okay, so we're going to do these last two. So we'll do The Symmetry of Chaos and then Carl Gibson's before we are out of here. Okay, here we go. Symmetry of Chaos. I have to process this for a second. All right, I'm good. Here we go. All right, he says, "Hi, team. Happy Monday. I would really love to hear what you guys think, the mix in general, and the dynamic of the master. It's a long track, so you can skip to the 3:40-minute mark. Thanks a lot." Well, we'll listen to a little bit at the beginning, you know? All right, let's see how it is. See, I would have missed that. That's cool. I'll just spot check up to there. Had my mic closed. It was closed. All right. So I would have missed all that cool stuff before. So what I wanted to say was I love the track. And then in this section here, the kick feels like it's too loud, but there's other percussion elements that are up there too. And I wanted to hear more mid-range. So the pad needs to probably come up unless you're mixing it for the club. In that case, I don't know. Because I haven't mixed for clubs. So I mixed for a stadium one time and we boosted up the kick in the bottom for it because they wanted it to literally rattle the stands. So I was on the like 50-yard line of a stadium with my Pro Tools rig mixing through their like sound system thing. It was weird. But yeah, anyway, that's up to you. Are you mixing this for a club was my question. And then I hit the mic button and then saw that I was muted the whole time. Here we go. One other thing, I've talked about this on other streams. I see it's open. Okay. the length of the kick drum too. Like, what is the note value of that kick? So right now it's happening, you know, on the quarter, it's keeping the pulse or whatever. It feels like the sustain of it goes into the next kick drum. And I'm wondering, like, if it came down right before the next beat hit, if you'd have more of a groove to it. That's one thing that we forget to think about with low end. I've talked about how subwoofers can extend the note value when you go to see a show and there's too much sub and everything just kind of sounds like crap. Multiple reasons, but like one of the big ones is like you're messing with the drummer's groove if you extend the note of the kick drum past what their intention was, right? So same with on a track like this, you want to be very intentional about the length of the sample and how much low end is in there. And that it, you know, either it gets out of the way in a musical way for the next note or it doesn't. But that it's intentional is the important thing. So moving on, I'm going to spot check here. There's on the accent, there's a resonance. It's like a 3K thing. On my left speaker. So whatever the accent is on the left speaker, there's a resonance in there that I think if you clean that up, it'll feel more pleasing. I think the mid-range on that filtered sound that happens right before everything comes back in, it's that sound feels too loud. Or not too loud, it feels balanced, but I think if it was a little quieter, it would give the downbeat a little bit more impact. Just a thought. This show may have strobing effects. I can tell the only things that I have to say are if you are more dynamic in those breather sections, like here, bring the level down of the stuff in between so that those drops or the re-entries, the downbeats, feel a lot bigger. And if you have a lot of limiting or bus compression on, just watch, because when that kick and all of that stuff goes away, it's going to, you know, raise up level and all that. So I would just automate some more breath in there. And same with this one right here, a little less volume before the downbeat. Yeah, I want it to feel like a tidal wave, you know, is coming in when that downbeat is on the way. So it's like everything is small and tiny in comparison, and then the downbeat comes and it's just like everything's huge. So you could even automate like the master section and just bring things kind of down to build some more dynamic in there. But it's awesome. The only other thing I have is just that sound on the left, just taking care of the resonance in there. Let me play a little more of that. Just smooth that out a little bit, and I think this is amazing. Like, I really don't have many comments on it. I would just, I'd watch the length of the kick drum, make sure that you're happy with that. And I got nothing. Sounds great. Awesome. Thank you for that one. Gave me an excuse to use my Stroblify. Yeah, killer. Watch the noise at the end too. And I think there was noise at the beginning. Yeah, just watch the noise things. Unless you like it, then don't. All right, let's see what else we got. We're going to do the one from Carl Gibson. Dark Roses. Yeah, here we go.
Feel you, but there's nothing in the way. Something isn't right here, can't you see? You love me, but you're asking me to leave. I will stand by you through all the thick and thin.
There's something in the tuning of the slide guitars, and then like before, just the slide guitars by themselves, and then when it entered with this piano, I heard it too. Just some intonation stuff to deal with. And I think that they're a little loud and they could be a little bit more ambient too, speaking of the slide guitars. And now I'm going to hit play and we're going to get the freaking amazing drop that happens going into this chorus. Here we go. Sorry, something squeezes down right here. I think on the word these. You know, these dark roses. Don't want you to go. These dark roses. Can't let you go. Okay, so Carl, I'm going off of memory here, but if memory serves, I like your drums more than the sample things that you had in there. That being said, they feel a little bit like they're missing some attack and like some crack to them, but it feels more natural to me too. So I'm liking what you got here. I wanted to hear, I actually like the tuning and stuff of the snare, but it doesn't have any snap to it. So I don't know if you have a bottom mic, but it feels like it just needs a little bit more crack. And that could be like, you know, maybe an EQ thing, like notching up some mids and some higher mids. I love this song, like totally love this song. The bass feels like it's a little overpowering now, and it's masking the drums, if you will. So you might have to play with balances and stuff now that you've got these new drums in here and all of that. Yeah, so decided to scrap my own drums I put to this mix and use the original ones. Okay. Well, you know, wait, so you replaced, it wasn't the samples, you replaced the actual drum track, and the groove feels a little different now. Do we have an old version of this that we can listen to as well? I don't think there's one on Mixtank. Carl, if you come back to the next Mixtank, which will be in 2 weeks from now, so not next Monday, but the Monday after, I'm looking at the date right now. If you come back, I would love for you to upload two versions of it and for us to all go down this road together. So it'll be on the 24th, will be our next one. I would like to hear your drums again, because there was something about the breaks, the down, down, those things felt more intense to me before and were really awesome. So yeah, I wish I had the other one like side by side with it. If we could do this next time, I think that'd be awesome. I'd love to do it. The song is fantastic. And I think that you're doing a great job on it. On this version, I feel like there's not enough snap on the drums and the bass is too loud. And there was some stereo stuff. And then the things I said about the slides, intonation, volume, and they could use some space around them. That's really all I got for it. I actually went to my monitor controller and checked like changing polarity. I can listen to just the sides or mono sum and all that. It wasn't there was something weird going on stereo like widening wise, but it wasn't as intense as I thought it was. So yeah, I'd love to hear like multiple versions of this next to each other on the next Mixtank. If you're around, we'll try and get to that. Cool, thank you so much for submitting it, Carl, and I hope that is useful. And everybody, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for submitting mixes. I won't be back on Mixtank until after AES. So please, if you guys are at AES, come to our Flux Hangout. I'd love to meet you guys in person and high five and all that stuff. It's awesome seeing you guys here every week. And thank you again to everybody that showed up. And yeah, I hope to see you in New York. If not, I'll see you guys on the 24th. And we'll be starting, I mentioned maybe last week that we were going to be bringing the Great Big Plugin Show. If you haven't seen that, it's like a YouTube plugin show that I had started doing. We've decided to turn that into a live stream, and you and I are going to discover plugins together. So unless it's something I've had forever and I want to talk about it live, I'll listen to like new plugins. So I'll have them installed before we start, but we'll open it up for the first time together and listen to it on track. So you guys can be like, oh, crank this up, or, you know, use it on this or whatever. And we'll kind of discover plugins together. That'll be a new live stream that we're starting at the end of the month, I believe, but I'll keep you posted on that. So on weeks that, you know, Mixtank is bi-weekly now, on weeks that Mixtank isn't happening, on the Mondays in between, we'll be doing the plugin show. So that'll be fun. And cool. All right. The camera's gone. The camera's gone. All right. Hold on a second. Maybe the camera will come back. I think it overheated. The camera's back. The camera's back. All right. Awesome. So great. I am looking forward to seeing some of you guys in New York, and we'll do the other live stream at the end of the month when we get back and AES is all wrapped up. If you guys haven't seen it, check out Snarky Puppy start to finish. It's up online. The new Brower video is amazing. There's more Snarky Puppy coming soon. We got the stereo mix video with Nick Hard. Go check out Empire Central from Snarky Puppy as well. That's out now, and it's an amazing record. So very cool. All right. Great to see you guys. Thanks again for being here. Cool, Carl. Looking forward to that. So sounds good. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for coming, and I'll see you on the next one. Bye-bye.